If you're separated, divorced, or maybe even still living with an unrepentant, sexually addicted, or unfaithful spouse, but you don't recognize them as the person you married and you find yourself still missing them, you may be asking yourself, what is wrong with me? Hi, I'm Kim Pullen, founder of Hope for Spouses, and welcome to this episode of Lunchtime Live. For those of you who are new to our ministry, I started Hope for Spouses after my husband and I were reconciled from a 4-year separation due to his adultery. And during that time, I just really tried to focus on the scriptures and get my healing through the scriptures, intimacy with God, and a safe circle of other people. And I really tried to get out of God's way. It was really hard. But I tried to get out of God's way. So we've been back together for about 5 years now, and we have an incredible emotional intimacy. And we really believe it's because God is at the center of that relationship. Now, when we initially separated after 19 years of marriage, I endured 4 holiday seasons, 4 Valentine's days, 4 birthdays, including my 50th, and multiple vacations without my husband. And the first 6 months sleeping alone was absolute torture. I think I averaged about maybe 4 hours of sleep for the first 2 months after our separation. And so I desperately missed him. But then after my life adjusted to a new normal, I realized it wasn't him I missed, but rather a hybrid of what I wanted him to be and a fantasy of what I thought he was. The more I explored those feelings, the more I realized what I really missed. I miss the familiarity of him, the regularity of him being there. I could sort of rely on him to be there, but I realized that my expectations didn't really match my reality. Sure, he had been there in body, but not in mind and heart. Those were somewhere else, even when he was with me and the kids. I also missed him lying beside me in bed. But then I remembered all the times I had him in bed beside me and still felt lonely because he was so far from me and God emotionally and spiritually for so long. He had isolated himself from me long before we separated. I also miss parenting together. But then I remembered how often I felt like I was parenting not just our 3 kids, but him as well, because he often acted more like a kid or a teenager than a mature adult. The more I thought about it, the more I realized that what I missed was really an illusion. It was something I wanted and never had. And after a while, I compromised and settled for something less than God's plan for marriage because either I didn't think I deserved more or because I didn't want to be rejected for wanting too much. As the time we separated grew, I found myself putting my hope in intermittent moments where he was kind or considerate or responsive, and I was thinking to myself, maybe he's changing. Then I would get disgusted with myself when I realized I was building my hope on isolated situations, but where there was no real repentance. I thought, am I that starved for attention from him that I'll settle for crumbs when God created me to feast on true intimacy? What I began to see was that I didn't necessarily miss him, but I missed having an intimate connection with another human being. I had become so isolated prior to our separation, isolated even from him when we were in the same room together, and isolated from friends and family who I was too ashamed to share with what I first suspected about his infidelity, and then after my 9/11, what was really going on in our marriage. My husband's sexual addiction not only robbed him of intimate connection with me, but I realized I also let it rob me of intimate connections with friends and family. See, a sexual addict doesn't know how to share real intimacy with another human being because they don't even know themselves. They spent their whole life hiding from their pain, their fear, their past, their struggles by using sex and other kinds of medication to anesthetize themselves. Think about it. How can you give yourself to someone else when you don't even know yourself, when you reject yourself? Why would you reveal yourself to someone else when you're too afraid or ashamed to face yourself? Expecting an unrepentant sexual addict or adulterer to be vulnerable, intimate, or honest is like trying to catch water in your hand or trying to draw water from an empty well. You will always come up empty, dry, and thirsty. It says in Isaiah 55:2, "Why spend money on what is not bread and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen, listen to me, and eat what is good, and you will delight in the richest of fare." But most of us are so desperate and so thirsty, we keep trying anyway, because we think our spouse is the only well we have to draw from. Our reluctance or resistance to face the reality of our futility often reveals how unhealthy we are. The truth is that our spouse should never have been the primary source of emotional and spiritual intimacy for us in the first place. That place belongs to God alone. Our spouse was supposed to be second. But even if or when that well runs dry, God has provided an additional source from which we can drink deeply. And that's safe people. Let's talk about our intimacy with God first, though. When we set our sights on creating intimacy with God, we must be committed to not just reading His Word. That's kind of knowing the what, but understanding the character of God, His deeper qualities, the whys and hows. I mean, we hear ministers or preachers talk about these qualities, but have never maybe explored them ourselves. Not exploring God's character through the Word is like having a relationship with somebody through a third party. It's crazy, and yet people do it all the time. We've done it. So when we commit to intimacy with God, it also means making a lifetime commitment to dive deep and discover some things about God, about His Word, and about ourselves we either didn't learn correctly, didn't learn well enough, or maybe didn't learn at all. And then we have to choose to have the courage to face that truth and change. In Jeremiah 9, 23 through 24, God says, "Let not the wise boast of their wisdom, or the strong boast of their strength, or the rich boast of their riches. But let the one who boasts boast about this, that they have the understanding to know me, that I am the Lord who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on the earth, for in these I delight." The primary way we build intimacy with God is through His Word, reading the Scriptures for ourselves. There are other secondary sources I can recommend, but just like the Bereans of Acts 17, 10 through 12, we always want to make sure we're going back to God's Word to make sure what our teachers are telling us is contextually accurate and true. Now, a few of those resources I want to recommend are a podcast called the Bema Podcast. And it really gives you a big picture view of the Scriptures from the Jewish culture for which the Scriptures were originally written. And it helps us to see our place in God's big story. There's also a really good course by John Sherwood called How to Read the Bible. And I recommend that because I don't want us to continue to make the very common mistake of reading something into the Scriptures that it was never meant to say or be translated as. There's another really good book called A Quick Overview of the Bible by Douglas Jacoby, and it gives an overall view of the Scriptures, and it really answers some of the big questions we probably didn't even know that we had about the Bible. Okay, now, about intimacy with God. Intimacy with others. Let's first resolve a fallacy. We don't need to be married to be complete and, yes, happy. Okay? That is something that has been hammered into us through culture, family, peers, the media, you know, and we've bought that lie that we need another human being to complete us. Jesus didn't, and neither did the Apostle Paul, and they were two of the happiest, most fulfilled, and complete human beings who ever lived. But we do need safe spiritual others in our lives to complement our strengths and weaknesses and call us to be more like Jesus. Now, that could be a spouse. I love being married, so I'm not saying we don't have to be, you know, we shouldn't be married. I'm not saying that at all. I love being married, and God designed marriage to meet some of those deeper needs. But it could also be close friends. It could be a parent or a mentor. It could be a coach, a boss, even a teacher. Mark and Debbie Laser, they're founders of an organization called Faithful and True, wrote a book together called Seven Desires. In it, they talk about every human's need to be heard, to be affirmed, to be blessed, to be safe, to be touched, to be chosen, and to be included. God designed us with these needs, and just because our spouse has made the choice to not meet them doesn't mean they can't be met. God meets every one of these needs we have through himself and through his body, the church. Now, the members of your church may not be able to meet them for you right now, but God's church is larger than just our congregation. One of the most important ways that you can get that safe support is with others who are walking this healing journey just like you, and they're using God's word to do it. So, if you are smacking yourself in the head, asking yourself, why in the world am I missing a spouse who doesn't seem to care about me? If you recognize you need to get your emotional needs met primarily through God, but you don't know where to start, or if you are looking for a safe community of others who are moving in the same direction, then I want to encourage you to go ahead and schedule a call with me. Go to hopeforspouses.com/call. Again, that's hopeforspouses.com/call. We'll get on the phone for about 45 minutes, give you an opportunity to share your story. And by the time you get off the phone, our goal is to make sure you have some clarity, you have some guidance, you have some direction on how to move toward healing. Now, if a call with me, a stranger, seems a little too daunting right now, or if you're ready to dive right into your healing, then please check out our ICU Kickstart Group Coaching Program at ICU2.com. That's ICEUTOO.com. Okay? Well, that concludes this episode of the Hope for Spouses Lunchtime Live. I'm Kim Pullen, and I'll see you next time. Take care.